Hi, Tony, and I want to welcome you. We're in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And just a little note, we're going to finish out 1 Corinthians just for continuity's sake. So hope that's okay with you. We'll get back to the prophets at another time. So how do you go about persuading headstrong, hard-hearted people who are living out of self-will? Well, that was Paul's task. So in chapter 8, he answered some of their questions. In chapter 9, he tried to use his own personal influence to get them to think like he thought. And now in chapter 10, he's going to take them through the only Bible they had, which happened to be the Hebrew Scriptures. Both 1 and 2 Corinthians were some of the earliest books of the New Testament to be written. And so he was using the Hebrew Scriptures that they were familiar with to bring them up to speed to what they ought to be doing. What we're going to do is Tony's going to read some scripture. I'm going to make some comments just to kind of get us in context, remind us of what they hopefully already knew.
1 Corinthians 10, 1 and 2. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud and all passed through the sea and all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea.
When God liberated probably a million slaves, 400 years of slavery in Egypt. When he did so, they walked across the Red Sea on dry land, but they also had the visible presence of God in a cloud. Thank God for that.
Exodus 14:19. The angel of God who was going before the Israelite army moved and went behind them, and the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. And all ate the same spiritual food.
And that is a reference in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. What was the spiritual food about? Well, in Exodus chapter 16, we can read actually the most of that chapter, verses 4 through 30, about how the people were complaining about, guess what? Just like the Corinthians, not having enough meat to eat. God sent them quail, which was difficult for them. Then he gave them manna, which was like their daily bread. So that's the scene. The Corinthians would remember, I see. That's what he's talking about.
And all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ.
That's a reference to Exodus chapter 17, 1 through 7. The people were thirsty. They were complaining about being thirsty. I would be too. And they were moaning and they were complaining. God sent Moses to a rock. He struck the rock. God sent forth water. Now, it's interesting, Paul says the rock was Christ. You know, and this is something we may have never thought of. Jesus has always been. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are all three one, and they have always, from before the creation of anything, from eternity to eternity, they are. We most know about Jesus as the man who walked on this earth for the first 30 plus years of the first century AD. But he also was present in the Old Testament as the angel of the Lord in the cloud, and then as that rock of provision from God. That's a great thing for us to think about. Now, profound spiritual experiences ought to change us. God's people in the Old Testament had many experiences that were history-making, and yet they failed. Let's see what Paul has to say.
Thus Paul could observe, nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them, and they were struck down in the wilderness.
So Paul reminded the church in Corinth of these examples so that they would turn away from their puffed up, prideful, self-centered way of life and turn to God's way. Here's some more examples.
Now, these things occurred as examples for us, so that we might not desire evil as they did. Do not become idolaters as some of them did, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink, and they rose up to play.
Now, that's a quote right out of Exodus chapter 32, verse 6. And the scene was, Moses had gone up on the mountain to meet with God, and the people got nervous, and so they made a golden calf, and they began to worship that golden calf. If we were sitting in Corinth today, we were hearing that, we would think, oh, Well, we're being led by our more wealthy members of the church to be told it's okay to go to the temples and eat meat. But those temples believe that the gods, little gods, the demons, they actually reside in those temples and join us while we're eating. Maybe that's not such a good idea. Also, the golden calf episode involved sexual immorality. And when they would leave the pagan temples in Corinth, guess what? They would go home and they would engage in pagan sexual immorality. Paul's waving a big warning flag and saying, don't go there.
We must not indulge in sexual immorality as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in a single day.
This is a reference to Numbers 25. There, the people joined the worship of the one true God to Baal. And the real danger in Corinth was that they were blending their Christian faith with what was going on in these temples. Now, they were maybe going there to get meat and to enjoy a dinner that was provided by a wealthy patron, but they were joining themselves to a system that was totally wrong.
We must not put Christ to the test as some of them did and were destroyed by serpents, and do not complain as some of them did and were destroyed by the destroyer.
So here's another example from the Old Testament, Numbers chapter 21, verses 4 through 9. The people were complaining, and God sent them serpents to correct them. Some of them died. But he also sent them a way for healing after Moses interceded for them. Again, the idea is you people in Corinth, or you people in Independence in 2021, pay attention to what's happening and learn from it. Well, it's easy to have 2020 vision, hindsight. The people in Corinth could look at the Old Testament and say, yeah, that's wrong. And we could look to our history. We could look at slavery and say how wrong that is. But had we been living in the 1850s, it might have been harder to discern. We can look at what the Nazis did in Germany and say, that's absolutely horrible. But had we been living in the 1930s America with a prevailing view towards Jewish people, we might have had a harder time seeing what was wrong. It's easy for us to look at the Corinthians and say, how wrong can you be? What we need to do is learn from them. Tony's got a couple of verses of Paul's advice for us.
Paul's final advice to the church then and now is, these things happened to them to serve as an example, and they were written down to instruct us on whom the ends of the ages have come. As a final warning to us all, he wrote, so if you think you are standing, watch out that you do not fall.
Boy, isn't that a good one? If you think you're standing, pay attention so you don't fall. Thanks for being with us today. God bless you. We'll see you again tomorrow. Have a great day.